pre-modern world systems. That's what it says in the program. It says something,
Well, to be more exact, I'm going to continue to focus on the Indian Ocean world system. So I'm a historian who's making this gigantic leap into sociology so that I can use world systems theory to as a framework for the history that I'm trying to do. And so I'm really straddling two worlds right now, so I hope you'll bear with me. When I'm with historians, I have something different to say so that they're educated about world systems. And when I'm with sociologists, I have a lot of history to talk about, so I won't focus so much on the world systems theory. So over the next few years, I've got three goals that I would like to accomplish. To use world systems theory to explore the pre-modern Indian Ocean world system from the end of the Gupta era to the entrance of the Portuguese into the Indian Ocean for maritime trade. And second, I'd like to expand on the definition of the information network, which I'll get to in a minute, in this pre-modern world system using the Indian Ocean world system as a case study, and explore how the information network relates to other networks that define and bound world systems. And then finally, I'd like to challenge the label of medieval to periodize the Indian Ocean world system, which is the most significant world economy in pre-modern world history. So in my opinion, the label of medieval doesn't really fit that kind of a event. So geographically, and now I went to Kinko's yesterday and spent money scanning maps to use in my presentation today, and none of them got saved onto my thumb drive. So this morning I had to come up with some different maps. This is a little fuzzy because of our projector problem, but if you'll notice, the dark lines are trying to show you the trade routes across the Indian Ocean and across Asia. As early as 150 CE. So you see that there's very extensive trade going on and communication between peoples in this, what I call the Indian Ocean world system. Because one thing that all of these people have in common is their connectivity eventually to this body of water. And that's why I consider it to be sort of the center of this world system. So geographically, I'm working off of K.N. Chowdhury's work, Trade and Civilization in the Indian Ocean. And he was very much influenced by Brunel's study of the Mediterranean. And he adopted the view that the Indian Ocean was a place where climate, geography, and everyday lives of people merged to form a system, some kind of a system, and at least a unit of analysis. And other scholars, like George Hirani, who did extensive studies of Arabian maritime trade. He includes this part of Africa down to this point, actually down to this point. And Edward Albers from UCLA will extend this border of the Indian Ocean world system all the way down to the Cape of Good Hope. So you have, it's for different people, this extensive area that is included in geographically. But the question is it a world system? How do we find the world system? So I'm not going to go into what a world system is, because I think most of you are very aware of that. And
why do you think
stuff.
That? Because you're talking to me. What about these people?
Well,
I might know something.
He might know something.
Maybe
I
don't
know. I learned a great deal about world systems from him. Okay.
Yeah. You're talking to him.
All right. So my advisor wants me to go ahead and give me some background. So Wallerstein is the person who introduces us to world systems theory. And a world system is a unit of analysis that's meant to examine large-scale social change by analyzing interactive social systems over time. And in particular, we tend to look at the rise and demise of core entities in the world systems. The modern world system, according to Wallerstein, is defined as a large societal system with an axial division of labor, meaning there's a core and a periphery, and having a single mode of production in his modern world system, that's capitalism, but being interstate and multicultural. So Wallerstein added the semi-periphery to the core-periphery model, which the semi-periphery tends to relate to the core as either subordinate military ally or as a broker that mediates the relationship between the developed core and the underdeveloped periphery. So in Wallerstein's world system theory, there are two kinds of world systems. There's the world empire and the world economy. A world empire is a system with a centralized imperial government at its core, and the central state drives the dynamics of the system. So none of these exist today. But the concept of the world empire closely relates to what we think of historically as ancient empires, ancient dynasties, ancient civilizations, and so on. When the empire is the core of a world system, the semi-periphery and the periphery are often tributary neighbors, subordinate military allies, independent city-states, colonies, stateless populations of various kinds, all within the hegemonic sphere of the world empire. A world economy, on the other hand, is a systemic economic system with broad hegemonic power and influence, but which does not have a single polity, such as an empire, at the core. Instead, its core is made up of collaborative states, organizations, and institutions that together systematize trade, finance, and political-military balance of power on a global scale. The modern world economy began around 1500 CE. So Wallerstein concedes that pre-modern world economies existed, but that they transformed into world empires. So for him, a world economy, if it did exist in pre-modern times, it developed into a world empire, and he uses Rome would be an example of this. The pre-modern world empires at times took on aspects of world systems, but according to Wallerstein, world empires either disintegrated and merged into greater core and into the greater core and eventually merged or were subsumed into the modern world system. So if you follow Wallerstein's reasoning, this area, which obviously has no central imperial core, which I identify this as a world economy, but according to Wallerstein, it would have transformed into a world empire, and this did not. Now, in Chase Dunn and Hall's Rise and Demise Comparing World Systems, they identify four networks. Or components of world systems that are the four networks that bound or define a world system. And these are the prestige goods network, the global goods network, the political military network, and the information network. These networks represent the modes of exchange or interaction in spatially bound world systems, from the modern world system to even small stateless world systems, such as the Wintu world system in Northern California. So world system scholarship is focused on the exchange networks and political networks, political military network, but the information network needs more exploration and explanation in terms of how it bounds the world system and creates change through its interaction with other networks. So first we have to ask, what is information? So identifying the breadth and efficacy of a pre-modern information network begins with a clear definition of information. Information can range from calls and shouts to signals using line-of-sight apparatuses, such as flags or signal fires, to face-to-face communication of complex concepts and ideas through speech, iconography, and writing. David Christian's concept of collective learning that he talks about in his book Maps of Time can be used to define information as human communications at their most evolved level. Christian has posited the concept of big history, accounting for 8 threshold events since the Big Bang that created something new in the universe, each one, a new level of complexity and momentum, rather than following what seems to be the normal experience of the universe, which is inertia and decay. those threshold events was collective learning, according to Christian, in the human species. Collective learning is the evolutionary adaptation that allows humans to create routine learning through communicating complex concepts and then passing that knowledge to offspring who also retain and recall learning. This is something that even our nearest relatives, the chimps, can't do. Only humans do this. Animals rely on calls and body language, and humans did for a time too. Humans took an evolutionary leap by which they formulate and nominalize complex self-conscious ideas. So this narrows the definition of information to human-to-human communication that advances human knowledge. It eliminates considerations, by using this definition of human-to-human collective learning to represent information, we can see how the information network becomes systematized as part of the system logics of the pre-modern world system. So Chaston and Hall posit that the information flows coordinate closely with trade routes, and you can see how that would be obvious. Because until the advent of the telegraph in the 19th century, information was tied to transportation in human history. It wasn't until after 1850 or even 1860 that we have a tremendous new event in human history. And that's when information is no longer tied to people actually carrying it or holding it in a form of a paper, a book, a papyrus, a scroll, or even in their own bodies as communication. And then communication in the pre-modern world only could travel as fast as horses, humans, or boats. So we have that consideration. One thing that we can use, we can try to utilize a cross-disciplinary approach to tracking these information flows. As long as we're only focused on the trade exchange networks and political military, we will miss things that we might learn about how the information flows. For example, one really good message bearing device is coinage. So let me just show you an example. This is Kushan coins from this period of the Kushan Empire, 30 to 375. And you'll notice that on the backside of these coins, we have the picture of the Kushan Emperor. But the flip side is going to have different deities and iconic figures from different cultures and religions. So some of these coins will have pictures of Hercules, some have Shiva, some have Helios, some have the Maitreya Bodhisattva. In this case, you have Mithras up here, and you have, now the Kushan Empire, The Kushan Empire is right in the middle, in Central Asia, between the Persians, the Indians to the south, the Chinese to the east, and they have their communications even with the Romans, primarily through Roman colonies. But here you have Buddha. And you even have, in Greek, Buddha, written here. But this little figure on the side, which appears on the back of every Kushan coin, is actually a Zoroastrian fire altar. So there's a little toss over to the Persians. There's a Mithras, who is a god of the Persians in the Zoroastrian tradition. So you can imagine these coins being distributed throughout this very central area. And you can track the distribution of these coins. And you'll notice that the information that's being given here by the Kushan Emperor is, we understand where you're coming from. We know that some of you are Buddhists. We know that some of you are Zoroastrians. You're welcome here, or our money's good as far as you're concerned. That's a piece of information that we can track and use that. But we can only use that if we'll study numismatics. And even a little art history to talk, you know, to see how the iconography changes or travels. Again, because when you're talking about diffusion of information, you have to be careful. careful that you're going to avoid things that might have spontaneously been created in different areas where there was no connection. So how do we find the things that truly did diffuse from one origination place and then move throughout this Indian Ocean world system? Another example is the iconography of the lion. And so here you have different dates. This is an iconography that is making its way from West Asia to East Asia over time. But not just the lion. I want to point out to you the lion's toes, the claws. This iconography pops up in all of these places all the way across this Indian Ocean world system. It's these very pronounced, stylized claws. And you see those claws here in the Neo-Assyrian Lamassu, the same claws, which is difficult with this lamp, but it's the same claws here in 250 BCE, and then again the same claws in a Chinese grave guardian, circa 6th century CE. So those are the kinds of things that numismatists, our historians, archaeologists, historians can bring to this discussion if world systems theorists will pay attention to that cross-disciplinary addition. One last thing I'd like to mention, too, about Chase Dunn and Hall is that they make the comment that because this information is traveling, here's a map that's showing the spread of religion, and you can see that the spread of religion is also following these same trade routes, the spread of Buddhism. But one of the things that they mentioned is that if a message starts here, by the time it gets to there, it will be garbled because it will have passed through so many people in a down-the-line trade. This is down-the-line trade so that these people up here don't actually meet those people down there, but their goods are being handled all the way along the line by different agents. So if the information is also being handled by different agents through this route, wouldn't the information be garbled by the time it gets to the other end? So that's a question that needs to be looked at, because if information is going to get garbled by the time it gets to the other end, it could mean that trade itself is going to collapse, because a lot of that information is information that you need in order to have successful trade. So these people need to know that there are pearls here. Otherwise, why would they take up the time and energy to, you know, beat the monsoons in order to get there just to find out there were no pearls there because the information about that got garbled along the way? So one of the things that I'll be doing in my studies is to examine the efficacy, the efficiency of this information network to see if it's really true that messages will get garbled by the time they get to the other end of the world system. So I know I don't have very much time left.
You're out of time.
Okay. So for another day, I'll talk about my pet peeve about medievalism. But I think you can understand where I'm coming from.